Subscribe Khetigaadi channel and press the bell icon for latest updates.
Namaskar, hello and welcome to Khetigaadi Agritalk. This is Vishnu and this time we bring you something special and exclusive. Known for their core values of innovation, integrity, commitment and quality, they've been delivering farm mechanization solutions for the Indian market for last 20 years. With a philosophy of with India, for India, John Deere, a leader in agriculture innovation, recently celebrated 20 years of their success in the Indian market. With three state-of-the-art manufacturing plants, they also achieved a milestone of manufacturing 1 lakh tractors per year. On the occasion, John Deere also launched new four-wheel drive tractor model 3028E with advanced technology and features for orchard farming and paddy farming. With a powerful intent of making a difference and empowering farmers, let's understand how John Deere is empowering farming community with their initiatives like agri entrepreneurships, solutions for small and marginal farmers, need and importance of custom hiring centers in India, current scenario of Indian farm mechanization industry, its future, and where does India stand today in farm mechanization as compared to the world. We will also try and understand how John Deere is a one-stop solution for farmers. Let's get into an exclusive interview with industry stalwarts Mr. Satish Nadigar, Managing Director, John Deere India, and Mr. Mukul Varshne, Director, Public Affairs, John Deere India.
So, congratulations to you for 20 years of success in Indian market and achieving 1 lakh tractor manufacturing for a year. That's really good. So, one thing which we noticed in today's press conference and which also came out to be really, really interesting for us in a press release is that John Deere is playing a role wherein you want to lead subsistence farming to agri entrepreneurship. So, what kind of a role is actually John Deere looking at? How is it going to help?
Well, we want to make sure that the farmers' yields are improving over a period of time, mm-hmm. and this can happen with the next level of mechanization and also providing the right kind of mechanization to the farmers in terms of precision farming. Okay, and we also want to make sure that, as you were mentioning, the farmers really buy the right tractor and they are also able to service them right way. And also I think one of the agri entrepreneurship is make sure that their income levels are going up as well. Now income levels can go up in two ways. One is by improving their yields,
okay,
right, and which can happen if they use the right level of mechanization, right implements, plus also they can also get some additional farm income too, right, in terms of renting out. You know, you may be knowing that most of the farmers also rent out at least 20-30% of their tractor available hours to the
absolutely
to the farmers. So that's kind of the entrepreneurship as well, which we want to take it to the next level as well, right?
So it's basically the farmer
income augmentation
with the entrepreneurship is what you are basically trying to say.
Cool. Income.
Yes. Okay. Now on the other hand, if you actually see the way Indian farmers are categorized, you know, 84% of our farmers are into marginal and mid farming segment, where the rest of them are into, let's say, big land holdings. But even then, this marginal farmers, they have a land size of around, let's say, 2 acres to 5 acres, whereas the big farmers are considered having lands of more than 10 acres. So how would John Deere look at this kind of farmers, where the land banks are really, really less in terms of technology and innovations for farming, in terms of mechanization? Yep. What is your thought on that?
So one of the areas we are looking at here is custom hiring centers, where farmers who could own tractors can also rent it out to others. Like, you know, not everybody needs to invest on the capital equipment that are needed for the agriculture. So they could use this and also rent it out as a customizing centers.
Mm-hmm.
So that's something that might evolve. Another important thing when you look at farm division is practically what is happening on the field.
Okay.
Because though on the records the farm might get divided to the son,
yes,
or three sons a farmer has, mm-hmm, probably two of the sons have moved to the urban areas, and one of them is actually tilling. And we see that happening very much in the when we go on the financing side. We are all the three brothers coming and signing papers, whereas actually one of the brother is actually cultivating. So that's one area that we need to look into. Okay, is the land division happening practically as much as it is happening on the records?
Okay.
Then in terms of, you know, technology usage, yes, we have to bring in the right technology at the right price point to the customers. And you know, the custom hiring will evolve over a period of time. It will not happen in the next 2 years, 3 years, but it has to evolve is what I would say.
But considering the success of custom hiring, I think Karnataka is one of the states which have been a little bit successful. Considering other states, it's going to definitely take some time. Where I'm coming from, sir, is that for the small land holdings, let's say a harvester which is going to basically harvest maybe around 50 acres of land, but a particular farmer would only have 2 acres of land. So what kind of technology is
harvesting is very clearly contracting.
Contract.
No farmer wants a harvester just for his field. If you look into the harvesters that are bought, these are basically started with Punjab farmers who would buy a harvester and go start from the south,
mm-hmm,
sometimes somewhere in Maharashtra or Telangana, then move up, you know, to into Maharashtra, then Madhya Pradesh, then you know, Chhattisgarh, and then start harvest UP in some, and then start harvesting in Punjab. That's how the crop cycle happens as well.
Okay.
So almost 100% of harvesters are bought by contractors.
Okay,
so that will happen, I would say.
Mm-hmm.
It's only on the tractor side where the next level of technology might bring in. And also I think, you know, the custom hiring, organized or unorganized. Unorganized is already happening.
Okay.
As I said, 20-30% of tractor usage is through renting, correct, on an average. So that's how it will evolve. On other products, whether it is sprayer, whether it is harvesters, it's going to be mostly contractor driven model.
Okay.
Even baling is going to be likely to be contractor driven model. Would you agree, Mukul?
I think that's right. But on your input that Karnataka model was the best, I think states like Madhya Pradesh have a far more robust and a much more matured custom hiring policy. And Telangana, we have experienced that. Gujarat definitely was the first to start that, and we were partners with the government of Gujarat in 2011 when PM Modi was the chief minister there.
Okay.
And we have had very successful custom hiring centers in that state. So I think the models, of course, each state has its own model, but the other states who are doing extremely well in this, of course, it's evolving. But some states.
But is it because of the subsidies provided by the government for that particular state, or it's just the behavioral aspect of farmers or the customer hiring centers? How does it basically work?
So it's the policy that you devise. See, custom hiring centers cannot be the cheapest tractor procured and rented out.
Yes.
I mean, it's got to be crop specific. It's got to have the technology for that particular agroclimatic conditions.
Okay.
And I think Madhya Pradesh does that pretty well.
Right. Now coming back to your product lineup.
Another important point in the custom hiring center is it's not like going point A to point B,
mm-hmm,
like Ola or Uber,
okay,
where you don't really care which car you're driving.
Sure.
Right? Here it is to grow with the livelihood of a farmer.
Yeah.
So it needs to be the right machine, the right implement, providing the right services to the customer. So it's going to be much more complex than a Ola or Uber model,
mm-hmm,
where the contractor or the service provider has to be with the farmer, understand the farmers through the life cycle. That's very, very important in the custom hiring segment. Again, customer hiring, you know, agriculture being a state subject, every state has their own definition of custom hiring.
Sure.
So that has been a challenge too for us to work in custom hiring. And this will evolve. In fact, some of the things we have been telling him, come up with a common custom hiring policies.
Yeah, I think that would help.
Yeah, that would help us also.
Yes. So coming back to your product lineup, you know, now you've almost, like, it's really impressive in terms of everything from 28 HP to maybe 120 HP product line you have. But do you think that there is a necessity or a need for a market like India to try and see whether the tractors below 20 HP has any need in the market? How is India aligned for that particular aspect?
Well, below 20 HP, you know, there may be a certain segment that may be needing that, but whether the farm is 1 acre or 10 acre, is still need the same power.
Okay.
To till the land, right? If it's a black cotton soil, you still need whatever 40 or 42 horsepower minimum.
Okay.
Correct. Even if it's a small tractor, smallest
yeah.
thing.
Yeah.
Correct. So that's important. Otherwise, you may not get the right mm-hmm. depth. You may not get the right tillage. So that's important. There could be still some soil like Gujarat where the soil is sandy or you know,
it doesn't need a lot of strength, maybe.
Yeah, it doesn't need a lot of power, so that's okay, but we don't think it'll go, you know, a big way into less than 20 horsepower, for example.
Okay.
Or even less than 25 horsepower for that matter.
So India
it's a segment that may grow a bit,
okay,
but will not grow like substantially.
Okay.
Otherwise people would have done it earlier, right?
Yeah, yeah, sure.
Yeah.
Sir, another aspect which be really great if you throw some light in terms of if you compare India as a country with other countries, let's say Japan or Australia or even Canada and US, the percentage level of mechanization has really gone to anything between 90% to 97%. I think Japan is the highest with 99%. Where does India stand today, and where do you see this mechanization go in, let's say, in next 3 to 5 years? What is the situation?
Well, when we talk about mechanization, it's for various farm applications, right?
Yeah.
For example, for tillage or land preparation, the mechanization levels could be about 80% to 85%. Okay. Whereas for harvesting, it again depends on crop to crop basis. For small grains, which is paddy, wheat, corn or maize and other this thing, it could be in above 50-60%, whereas for cotton it is almost zero, for sugarcane it is less than 5%.
Okay.
So harvesting side it is on an average we say about 25-30%, and whereas on the crop care, which is spraying,
mm-hmm.
okay, and then intercultural applications, it's very very less. You still have people with knapsacks, you know, spraying with
yes,
masks and all, so
yeah.
that's almost zero, I would say.
Okay.
Then the post-harvest, which is, you know, baling, managing residue, all of that stuff is also less than 5%.
Okay.
So when it comes to overall mechanization, it could be still in the 40% to 50% range for
okay.
India as a whole. So, right, Mukul, would you agree with that?
Yeah.
And where do you see it going in next 3 to 5 years?
It's going to take a while on the each one of the. I think small grains, I mean combine harvesting, it will grow.
Okay.
Okay. Whereas cotton picking, it may be slowest.
Mm-hmm.
Sugarcane, it is starting to be there. Maybe another 10 years, it may be about 10%. You don't know, because still, though the labor availability is a problem, but labor that's available is much less than mechanized harvesting, the cost of labor for that.
Okay.
So we'll have to see how that evolves.
Okay.
And labor, rather than the labor cost, it's labor availability, that's a challenge.
Yeah, that's a challenge, yes, absolutely.
Yeah,
we agree with you on that.
On the sugarcane harvest
yes.
side, particularly.
I'll just ask last question to him and then we'll end with one question to you, sir.
Yeah.
What's your plan in terms of your partnership with Witgen as a brand in India? I mean, where do you want to take that partnership, let's say, for next 5 years? What do you want to achieve with that? I'm sure it's a very objective-driven kind of a partnership.
It's not a partnership, it's actually own company.
It's takeover.
It's own company.
Okay.
And, you know, and you may want to refer to some of the other documents that were released from corporate level on the Witgen side.
Sure.
We want to make sure that it is a very, very successful business. And they have very good market shares, even in India as well. And they are running a very successful business. So it's going to be a brand that will continue to grow, I would say, Witgen as a brand. Now it will continue to operate like as a John Deere company, but there's no plan for any final integration or anything. Of course, wherever we can leverage each other's strength, we leverage. Like John Deere Financial can start funding organic equipment.
Yeah, that's another thing.
Some
I
of those things that will come up.
Wanted to ask, because financing a tractor is also a bit, let's say, a complex and a critical thing.
Yeah.
In terms of, because the dealers are also involved, they have various options. So how do you get into that entire business? When, what is that you're offering to the customer in finance?
At the end of the day, for the customers, it's about speed. Or loan application is pretty fast. Loan processing is very fast. And we offer 100% transparency to the customers. Then we make sure that the dealers get their funding quickly.
Okay.
Because their working capital can
yeah.
be faster if we fund customers quickly.
Okay.
And then we are very competitive in the marketplace. In terms of, and there are opportunities that equipment company and finance can work together to penetrate
empower
more,
maybe, yeah,
more
empower.
Equipment.
Okay.
The farmer has one-stop solution.
Yeah.
Sure. So you've been liaising with the government. You've been handling public affairs. Of course, India as a country will definitely need to grow in terms of mechanization. What is your opinion on the current status of government support? What is the scope of development? And what is one of the best things government has done? What do you think on that?
See, this is a little tricky question, but just to tell you, I think the structural reforms that we see are in the positive direction.
Okay.
And when I say positive direction, there is a large focus on water availability to the farmers. There's a lot of focus on micro irrigation. The government also wants to bring electricity to the villages, which is again adding significant value. And the third important thing is availability of roads right in the village levels.
Okay.
So the produce can be quickly transported. Electricity, the farmer can do agriculture or minor processing at the village. And water is essential for this. So these three things, the way the government is trying to plan and improve, is definitely going to have a positive impact in agriculture. Gujarat is one good example, and MP is one good example. Bihar is another good example. I think other state governments are also following the suit.
Sure, deploy these things, definitely.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, sir. It was a pleasure speaking to you.
Thank you very much, sir.
Take care.
Thanks. And wish you good luck for your Khetigaadi and
Khetigaadi.
Do well.
Yeah, Khetigaadi is doing well, actually.
Yes. Thank you very much.
Thanks,
sir. Thank you.
Have a good
thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching the interview. Please leave your feedback in the comment section. Like, share and subscribe our Khetigaadi channel for agri and mechanization updates. Thank you.